So Anna, are you dating anyone now?
No, I'm currently not dating anybody. I've decided to take a break from dating for a while, I think. I've had a kind of, I guess it's sort of a self-realization that I think it's, I'm in a very transitional part of my life.
Do you have any regrets about your last relationship?
No.
Like the Ben thing, would you have hoped it went a little differently?
No, I don't have any regrets about anything.
You know, you may be the best friend I've ever had.
Describe your ideal man or husband.
You mean, like, what kind of qualities would they have? I don't know, I guess somebody who is caring and understanding, sensitive, easygoing.
Well, what was wrong with Connor?
I just think that Connor's better left as a friend. I think that he's gonna make somebody a wonderful husband someday. It's just not me.
Now I guess he's dating your friend Mary. Is that awkward for you guys?
Not at all. I love Connor and, you know, I love Mary, and I think that they're kind of a fun couple. I mean, who would have seen that coming, you know?
Any other thoughts on relationships that you'd like to share?
It's strange for me to talk about because I'm just, you know, I've decided, I think I'm gonna end up just traveling for a while. I have a trip planned. Good friend of mine and I are going to India for a few months. Actually, we're going on a yoga retreat, believe it or not. So that's kind of where my life's been going. That's the direction my life's been going more towards. And that, I think, is, you know, what I've been focusing my energy on is more sort of, as I said, like a self-discovery as opposed to dating. I don't know, maybe dating's a little overrated.
So Ben, so we're doing some follow-up interviews about relationships.
So I can help you out there.
Are you married?
Okay. I was married. Well, I still am married. Yeah. Well, I'm still married, but legally separated. She left me. Yeah. She actually lined my clothes up in a very systematic way and left me a note telling me that that maybe we should move on from each other. But you know what? She was right. She was absolutely right. And in a way, it's definitely for the best. I mean, I think that I probably wasn't man enough to do it myself. You know, I think she made the right choice.
Do you have any regrets about your former relationship?
Yeah. Oh, God, I have a lot of regrets. The main one is probably how it ended. I think that I forced her hand.
Light! Set! Shit!
And that, you know, in retrospect, I wish I should have just sort of taken the bull by the horns and did it myself. You know, sometimes you meet somebody in your life and you think that you're not sure it's quite it. And if I have any advice to give, it's, you know, don't try to make something work when it's not working. And know when to get out.
Hey.
Hi. Can I come in?
Yeah, of course.
If you're lucky enough, you'll meet somebody else. And if you haven't worked your shit out, you're not able to be with that person.
So, I mean, what's your ideal dream wife?
What's my ideal dream wife? I can tell you she's a blonde. She's got a pretty damn good singing voice. And, she's smart enough not to be with a guy like me.
Is honesty the best policy?
There's a time and a place to be honest. And if you're not, And you gotta be smart about when you choose to be honest. And if you do it for the wrong reasons, then it doesn't matter. If you're honest just to save your own ass, you're not doing anybody else any favors.
I knew it, you asshole.
I'm sorry, I'm sorry.
That's a tricky slogan. Honestly, it's the best policy. Loving somebody is the best policy. And sometimes that means you're honest, and sometimes that means you have to protect them.
Beth and Neil, how do you see the next few years now that you're married? Are you gonna stay in this place?
Now that we are married, every single thing will be fundamentally changed. That is a joke. Wow. What do you think? I don't know. What do you think?
I think we need to move out of here. I think we've been here. I think we've done this.
Okay.
Don't you?
Absolutely.
Do you know what you feel like? Okay, done. Been there, done it. Represents a lot of bad. Not great. I mean, not bad. I meant.
Let me tell you something. People who get married are not to be trusted.
You are so weird.
Can you tell us what the perfect date night would be?
What do you think? I'd like to hear your idea of a perfect date.
I don't know. What do we usually do? We go out sometimes. We go out and eat, right? We see art exhibits
sometimes.
We do. We go.
Did you show him that I painted some of those?
Yes, some of your better work.
And some of his. He loves a swimming pool. This guy, I tell you, loves a good swimming pool. See that up there? And there's another one. That's actually a jacuzzi. That's not actually a pool.
But I don't like them filled with water.
No.
Can't have any water in them.
And also the background, the surrounding land doesn't want to be invited. It's not inviting. These cannot come.
My pants?
That's correct.
So whatever happened to that pair of pants?
The pants.
The pants are in fact still here.
We just can't really talk about in what capacity that they're here, but they're, it's a long story.
Probably won't have to get rid of them now, because they have some sentimental value.
That's correct.
So what do you like about each other?
What do I like about her? There are too many things to think about all at once.
It's hard. It's a tough question. It's like, who's your favorite actor?
Right.
You just can't, so your mind gets
My mind is flooded.
You're flooded.
Yes. There's too many things to think about.
She is
her tremendous patience, her profound understanding.
Wow.
Her enormous capacity for giving, understanding, forgiveness. Yeah. Where do we go?
All of it. You can just pretty much say all of the above.
Will you marry?
Yes, of course I will. Yes. Yes. Well, that's what I love about you is that you really, truly, I have to say, one of the most honest and upfront and forthcoming men that you could end up being with, and just sort of says it like it is. I didn't really, took me a while to really figure that out.
All right, Alex, Gigi, let's go back in time a little bit. Let's go back to when you guys first met. Was it love at first sight?
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Tell me about that. It seems to me that you guys were friends first before, right?
I mean, I guess technically.
Yeah, really, was it for you? Because, was it?
Of course.
This is maybe like a bullshit answer, but it was love at first sight in hindsight.
Yes, absolutely. It was love at first sight in hindsight.
Does that make any sense? Can you say that? Is that like a cop-out?
It was love at first sight in hindsight.
What kind of advice did Alex give you that sort of helped you with your relationships?
What advice did I give you that helped you? I don't even know. I mean, it's okay. Feel free to say none.
No, you changed everything. No, stop it. Okay,
I'm making out with this guy, PG stuff, and he mentions that he's going out of town, so he's gonna be out of touch.
Run.
We're actually... We've been working on this self-help book. And it's based on the things that Alex taught me.
You're working on it.
It's about how to tell if a guy, or a woman, is or is not into you. We haven't come up with a title.
If he ain't calling, he ain't balling.
So how long have you guys been dating?
It's been, 3 months, two
he
weeks,
knows to
and
the
six
hour.
Days. I do. I'm not ashamed of it. 3 months, 2 weeks, and 6 days. I don't know the hour. Do you know the hour? Don't tell me you know the hour.
I get in trouble on our 1 month anniversary if I don't.
All right. Tell me about your first kiss. Who made the first move, and how long did it take from when you met?
That's a tough one because technically...
Because you jumped on me in a hallway.
Well, technically you had jumped on me prior to that. And when I say jump, like, you know how velociraptors attack? Like, with the things on it?
We would not be here, sitting here now.
I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm just saying that technically was the first time.
Yeah, okay.
Oh, yes. I knew it. The best relationships grow out of friendships.
What did you guys do with the famous pen?
Ooh. I feel like that pause is going to be interpreted as something sexual. What did we do with the pen?
It's framed. We framed it. It's hanging in my kitchen.
Well,
in a shadow box.
She means her. Wilson Ward, DDS, Adult Child and Geriatric Dentistry. But I'm into it. I love it.
What do your friends at the Spice Company think of your relationship with Alex?
We actually go on double dates with...
Yes, we do.
When Janine goes on dates and we've gone out with Beth and her husband.
Neil, the Ben Affleck lookalike. True or false, that guy looks exactly like Ben Affleck.
He does not look anything like Ben Affleck.
You're insane. In fact, when I met him, I thought he was Ben Affleck.
Where do you see yourselves 10 years from now?
I don't know. I mean, it's funny. We had this conversation the other night. We were just talking about some crazy shit about the future and whatnot, and it's nice that we're both sort of on the same page about living in the present and being sort of more present-minded, which is not to say it hasn't come up in, like, very kind of abstract ways. Like, I hope one day that we, I don't know.
What?
We'd move in together, or, like, whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Would you guys move in here?
Maybe a halfway house. No, I mean, I would.
You like all my cat stuff.
I like is a very strong word.
You like, I catch him playing with my little.
I don't play with it. I've never had cats of my own, so it's a new thing for me. I just have to get it out of my system. I don't play with them. I make believe.
You guys seem so happy. Do you ever fight about anything?
We fight about how much Neil looks like Ben Affleck. That's really all we fight about.
Janine, would you say that you were happily married?
I don't know. I guess it depends when you look at it. You know, I mean, at the time, I guess I thought I was happily married. In retrospect, I think probably not. I have a cold, sorry.
What do you miss the most about your marriage?
I don't know. Right now? I mean, it's strange because we knew each other for such a long time that... The part of it is just, there's so much of it that's just habit, you know? All that stuff that you're so used to for so long. It's strange breaking habits and finding new ways to fill your time, I think. But in a way, I'm really so much happier than I've been in so long. So, of course I'll miss him, you know? He was my best friend for so many years, but I'm really so much happier.
What bothered you the most about what happened between you two?
I think it's really important to be able to trust the person that you're with. I think it's really important to be straightforward and honest, and so that was a problem for me. I think if one person is being dishonest, then they're sort of holding all the cards, you know? And then I think there's a lack of balance. I don't really think that's fair.
What could Ben have done differently?
I wish you would have been straightforward with me. I wish we could have had that kind of a relationship.
Hmm. Are you smoking again?
No, sweetie, I'm not smoking.
I hate lying. I really hate lying.
What are you looking forward to most about your new life?
I love my friends and my job. I really like my new apartment. And I'm really enjoying spending time with my friends.
Let's look up places for your destination wedding.
Do you ever see much of Alex and Gigi anymore?
Yeah. Well, we're still working together. So, you know, I see Gigi all the time. The roles have gotten slightly reversed, I think. She's been great. She's a great friend, and I'm so happy for them, you know? It's just perfect. It's really perfect.
So, tell us about your first date.
You never go wrong with dinner in a movie, so that's where we started. We went to, what was the name of that place?
Pache?
Pache.
Right.
That's right, we went to a place called Pache, and it's up on a little hill. It was nice.
Yeah.
And then we went to, what's the Indian movie?
A scary movie is always good for
you
a first date.
Never go wrong with a scary movie, too, because it's a lot of them. Yeah. Close to me.
So now that you've been dating a while, what do you guys like to do?
What do you like to do?
We stay home a lot. I mean, we spend a lot of time together. We watch TV. We go out. You know, we go out with our friends.
We go to dinners. I love going to dinner. Dinner's like my favorite thing. And it's like at 11 a.m. I'm already saying like, honey, baby, sweetheart, like, what are we doing for dinner? I want to make our plan now so I know that I have something to look forward to all day long.
We like wine. We like to drink wine.
Yep.
Eat dinner. You know,
we went on a wine tasting trip. Oh, that was really exciting. I drank a little too much.
That was fun. That was a good time. That was one of our best early dates.
Yes.
For sure. That was
a big
on
one. That was like, ooh, like making
like overnight
plans.
Yeah, exactly. I thought you sounded attractive on the phone.
So, what'd you think? Really?
We talked on the phone a lot beforehand.
You were funny on the phone, too.
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now. I'm not sure about this.
You made me laugh. In fact, that's part of why I got excited that I thought you were so cute, because I felt comfortable on the phone with you.
Thank you.
Like myself. Like I could be myself. Like I didn't have to put on an act.
When I first saw the ad in this paper, I was like, I wanted to almost be confrontational on the phone. And the minute I heard your voice, I was like, okay, I can't. I like this girl. She's sweet.
What are your favorite things about each other?
Well, I don't know. Let me think. My favorite thing about her, I don't know. It's just the way that she makes me, just the way she makes me feel. You know what I mean? I know that I can always be myself around her. And she's just, you know, beautiful, too. She's one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen. So for me, that about covers it.
That was going to be my answer. You stole it. I get to be myself with you, and that I think you're beautiful.
So that's good. We have the same answer.
Exactly. See? Meant to be.
Exactly.
You don't even know if he's called.
Oh, did he?
No.
Why are you married again?
People who get married are not to be trusted.
It's totally clear to me now.
He's just not that into you.
He's just not that into you. Maybe the first feature film inspired by one line of dialogue from a television show.
The phrase, he's just not that into you, came about in the writer's room of Sex and the City.
We were on a lunch break one day, and one of the girls asked me about a relationship that she'd been having for about a month with this dude. She'd invited him up to her place, and he turned it down. He said he had to work or some such nonsense. And somewhere along the line, I said, he's just not that into you.
Ouch.
Oh. It kind of was like a bomb had been exploded in the room, and we couldn't stop talking about it for days.
And that phrase sort of stuck. And then all the girls started asking me questions. I was like, what is happening?
But what if I'm the exception?
No, you're not. You're not at all. In fact, you're the rule.
We knew it was going to be in the show, because anything that causes that huge reaction in the writer's room always ends up on the show.
The day after the episode aired, they started talking about it on The View. So we sort of knew we were onto something, and Liz was the one that was like, this is a book. It's a book. I'm like, it's a pamphlet that you hand out at a bar on a Friday night as a courtesy.
The goal was to pretty much have every excuse a man has ever given covered in the book.
So there's not one woman that could read it and be like, well, that's not me.
The book came out, and 2 weeks later, we're at Oprah.
And that was just surreal.
All of my friends used to tell me these stories about how things might work out with these dipshits because they knew someone who dated a dipshit just like mine, and that girl ended up getting married and living happily ever after. But that's the exception, and we're not the exception, we're the rule.
It is something that is very painful with which to come to terms. The phrase, he's just not that into you.
We really did identify problems where people read the book and it's almost like a crystal ball and they go, that's me.
Women spend a lot of their life trying to decode messages when I think men are probably being more honest than we even realize, but we try to think they're doing mixed messages, or men do send mixed messages, so we waste our time decoding them.
Maybe he did call and I didn't get the message. Or maybe he lost my number, or is out of town, or got hit by a cab, or his grandma died.
If a guy doesn't call you back after 4 or 5 days, that's it. You know, he's just not into you.
Or maybe he just didn't call because he has no interest in seeing you again.
Doesn't mean that he dislikes you or he doesn't even find you attractive. You know, he's just not that into you.
He's just not that into you is just so simple and straightforward. It's so tangible. And I just was sort of relieved when the phenomenon swept the nation.
It all just became this whirlwind thing. And of course, you know, when something gets hot, people go, we should make a movie out of that.
I had all of these ideas and how to sort of make this ensemble about the notion of he's just not that into you without ever really saying that line.
If a guy doesn't call you, he doesn't want to call you.
Huh.
I got the best writers in town, Mark Silverstein and Abby Cohen. They came up with how the story would unfold and how we would meet these people and who would be involved with who. And we just really grew it from there.
They were very trusting. They were very trusting that we could take, you know, all these different characters and do something that felt funny and real without making it, you're sort of down the middle romantic comedy.
Yeah.
So you must be Dan.
Sort of.
Sort of.
Well, I'm actually a Wiccan.
Wiccan.
Yeah. Male witch.
Right. Oh.
Yeah. So I also have a magical name.
I had the fortune over the past few years to work on the show The Office, which seems to have as its signature very relatable and embarrassing behavior.
Okay. Bye. We tried to make it a lot more awkward and sort of painful.
Like dating is awkward and painful.
When I read the screenplay, I was immediately struck by the fact that of these 9 characters, I related to all of them. I had embarrassed myself in the ways that all of them had. I knew that an audience would also have the pleasure of sort of seeing themselves reflected 9 ways.
He said he always hangs out after work at the City Supper Club. Maybe I should do a little drive-by?
Please don't.
I related to every story in this movie. Ken did too. So the discussions with everybody, even in casting, was all very empirical. It was all about how people can relate to these situations.
It's unheard of to have such a phenomenal group of people working together. And I think that speaks volumes about the writing, because I think that story is first and foremost.
This was truly my dream script. And upon reading, my first reaction was, I would do anything to play Gigi.
The script felt very real to me and honest, so I hope that the audience has that same reaction that I had when I read it, which was, you know, you can't believe how some of these scenarios relate so closely with your own life or your best friend's life or something like that.
They're compelling relationships that are dynamic and filled with conflict, real conflict. And I think that's, anybody can relate to that who's ever been in a relationship. I mean, there's a lot of honesty in the behavior of these characters.
Well, if you're not wood, don't try and look like wood.
I don't think that it's pretending.
This is a lie, Ben. Just be upfront and tell people what you really are.
I liked following these different stories of these different characters to different sort of, you know, scenarios, and that being relatable to people.
I just need you to stop being nice to me unless you're gonna marry me after.
I think this is a great character study, a human interest story on what we do as human beings, which for the most part is, I think, sit around and try and figure out how to make relationships work.
Mary.
How we get there, the journey, is the most interesting, fascinating thing.
Jenny. Oh, Jenny, Jenny, Jenny.
The read feels real and the movie feels real because it is real. It's from real stories.
Going against nature is like the cat that nursed that monkey. You and I are just two people who don't happen to be married.
Most of these stories, I mean, have some sort of kernel of real life truth from either us or Nancy. I had a couple stories. Most of this stuff has happened one way or another.
Would you mind helping and just
kind of like co-hosting?
The idea of when a guy invites you to a party that you think you might be seeing, are you co-hosting, are you just a guest? That came from a girlfriend of mine who went to a party, just kept hanging around till it's like 1:30 in the morning and everybody's gone home because she's like, am I meant to stay or was I, you know, sort of those awkward beginning of relationship things really came from friends of ours.
Yeah. And
he was cute.
Yeah, please don't cyberstalk him.
He's just not that into you. It's hard to define.
It's a genre I'm not sure how to describe because I think it's more than a romantic comedy.
In most romantic comedies, there's a man and a woman, and the question is not whether they'll get together, but how.
One of the intriguing things about this movie is certainly the way that not all of the storylines are wrapped up in a neat bow.
We've upped the ante a little bit.
See you later.
There are 9 characters, and the question is, will any of them get together? The toughest part about doing an ensemble story is that you want to create a lot of variety, and at the same time, there needs to be some consistency between all the players and all the stories. It's in effect like a theme and variations form in music. The theme of this picture is how people misread signals between one another, and we're going to play out that theme in 9 different variations.
Maybe he's away on business.
He sells real estate in Baltimore.
Ken Kwapis is the ideal actor's director. Ken actually stays right by the camera when you're acting. At first, I was a bit taken aback by it because I was, you know, he's right there doing the scenes, but now I love it.
So he's right there. He's not like off in the distance. He's very present, and he's got real definite ideas about what he wants out of a scene. And that's really what, when as an actor, you're looking for a director that knows what he wants out of you, and he's there 100%.
Ken just has the most amazing suggestions. He just surprises me all the time. He really has an amazing, gentle way about him.
Ken does not yell action, nor does he sit behind a monitor. He stands by the camera and kind of softly he'll go ahead. And you know, it's sort of like, at your leisure, as you will. And there's something that's just so, you know, easy about that instead of like that action that sort of jolts you into like, oh right, I'm acting and I need to like be in the, you know, it's just, go ahead.
Go ahead.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Maybe the reason I don't say action is because I want to give everyone the sense that we're just involved in a process. We're working something out. It's a work in progress.
And go ahead.
At the end of a scene, well, we move on to another scene. And at the end of a picture, we move on to another picture.
Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
here you go. Seriously.
Okay, thank you.
Let's cut.
The film kind of holds up a rather harsh mirror to ourselves. And I think that the reason that Ginny's character is so memorable and her performance is so brave is that she's really making an ass out of herself. She is really a train wreck. She's really showing you ways that you've been, and you may not want to be reminded of it, but maybe it's better that you are.
You know what? Let's just say that you'll call me and then we can skip all the nonsense.
Goodbye, Eugene.
The line, he's just not that into you, is supposed to be helpful for people.
Actually, if it were a phrase that we were willing to accept into our lives, I believe we would save ourselves a lot of pain and suffering.
Just trying to trim some of the drama out of my life.
It's gone from a great saying and a great statement and a great book to a really multifaceted, fantastic ensemble.
It's very realistic, you know? I mean, all of the endings, you know, some of them are sort of sad, some of them are kind of a rebirth or, you know, a new beginning, and that's, you know, as is life, I suppose.
You need a spark?
No, it's bullshit. You don't need a spark. Bullshit on spark. Spark thing, the whole spark thing.
So we're gonna cut.
Cut.